A very good morning to you all, and also a very warm welcome to this, our King's School Sunday service on this Trinity Sunday. Thanks for this service go to Mr. Bursey and his choir, and to Stephen Layton and the choir of Trinity College, Cambridge for our hymns. Let's then steel our hearts and minds as we come together in prayer and praise. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. And so as we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen.
O Lord, open thou our lips,
and our mouth shall show forth thy praise.
So let us join together in singing our first hymn, All My Hope on God is Found.
Thank you.
Holy God, faithful and unchanging, enlarge our minds with the knowledge of your truth and draw us more deeply into the mystery of your love, that we may truly worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first reading comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 40, beginning to read at verse 28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Here ends our first reading.
Our second reading comes from Matthew's Gospel, chapter 28, beginning to read at the 16th verse. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Here ends our second reading.
Be sure that the Lord is good. May I speak to you in the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. That story you've just heard of Jesus having died and rose again, and then meeting with his disciples on a mountain, always makes me smile when it says, some of his disciples worshipped and some doubted. Poor Jesus, I think, must have been standing there thinking, what else do I have to do? I've been crucified, but here I've conquered death and I'm proving it by standing here in front of you. Yet you're still doubting. You're still uncertain. I find it interesting that Matthew, the gospel writer, includes this verse in his account. I mean, if you were writing to convince people that Jesus really was the Messiah, would you want to admit that even his own disciples still had doubts after seeing him in person? Perhaps Matthew includes this to let us know that there is a place in God's family for those who are uncertain. Maybe it's an acknowledgement of all those times when our understanding does not match with our experience. Matthew is showing us that faith and doubt go hand in hand. Having doubts does not disqualify you from following Jesus. But how do we make sense of God's love in a world of suffering, inequality, and injustice? How do we trust in God when all around us is so uncertain, when people are dying, livelihoods are being lost, human rights injustices continue to be perpetuated, and violence is breaking out? Jesus' response to his disciples was not to get rid of those with doubts, or even to challenge them about it. Instead, Jesus gives his disciples a job to do. Go, therefore, he tells them, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything that I have taught you. Jesus knew that it was natural for them to have doubts, to be uncertain. But Jesus also knew that experiencing the promises of God, even when they didn't really understand them, would in the end prove to his disciples that God's love does conquer all, that death is not the end, that even in the darkest of situations there is hope. I have spoken with some of you this week who have doubts and uncertainties about how best to respond to the Black Lives Matter movement. You want to stand against oppression, racism, and injustice, but you don't want to support acts of violence as part of these protests. It is right that, as our Archbishops of York and Canterbury have said this week, that we make a stand. I quote from them when they wrote, "Racism is an affront to God. It is born out of ignorance and must be eradicated. We bear the responsibility and must play our part to eliminate this scourge on humanity." And they went on to pray that God's abounding wisdom, compassion, and love will guide us all to forge a better society. God's abounding wisdom, compassion, and love. I don't think that includes violent acts of protest. Jesus sent his disciples out into a world of hate, oppression, injustice, and inequality 2,000 years ago. He told them, "Teach people everything I have taught you." And what he had taught was that we should love one another as God loves us, because only by this will the world know that we are his disciples. So we need to find ways of making our voices heard through non-violent direct action. Dr. Martin Luther King famously said, "Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that." The beauty of nonviolence is that in its own way and in its own time, it seeks to break the chain reaction of evil. So this morning, maybe we are being challenged and commissioned, as the disciples were 2,000 years ago, to go into the world and make disciples. Disciples who continue to work for equality. Disciples who work for peace and harmony. And disciples who shine God's light of love, hope, and life in our world. How will we go about doing this today? Amen.
This morning's anthem is William Harris's Faire is the Heaven, previously recorded by the Crypt Choir.
Peace.
As we come together as the family of God, let us bring to him our prayers and petitions. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for our church and its people, and gladly acknowledge all the gifts that you have given us through its life. We ask you to open wide our hearts that we may welcome the stranger and share our faith with others. Open wide our minds that we may receive new truth and understand your will. Open wide our doors that as we have come into worship, so may we go out with you to the service of the world. Open wide our lives that through discipline and prayer, we may experience your power in daily living. Lord, you have chosen men and women to serve you in the ministry of your church and given them a perfect example in the person of your Son. Pour your blessings on your servants today. We pray especially this for Justin, our Archbishop, and Rose, our Bishop, that by word and deed, they may proclaim your saving love and so enable us all to grow in your image. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of the universe, we praise you for your creation. You have provided humanity with everything in it needs for life and health. Grant that the resources of the earth may neither be hoarded by the selfish nor squandered by the foolish, that all may share your gifts. We remember all who bear the responsibility of leadership, for heads of state, ambassadors, and diplomats. Let all work for the common good and build up our mutual life together. Lord, we pray for peace in the world. Create in us a love for peace, not peace that is absent from struggle, nor peace that is blind to injustice, but peace that makes whole what now is broken. We remember those who struggle against injustice, for men and women who have to establish love's supremacy in violent and oppressive societies, and for those whom war and famine have robbed of homes, families, and friends. May they be filled with your strength and wisdom, and grant that where the love of man has failed, your divine compassion may heal. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember this morning those who are sick, sad, or lonely, and those who are brave and patient when these things are going wrong. We pray that they may be aware of your comforting presence and know that in your hands they are safe and loved. Lord, we pray for all those whose life is saddened by the death of a loved one. Be with them in their loneliness, and let them know that Christ is the light of the world, a light which no darkness can quench. Heavenly Father, in a moment of silence, we bring before you those who weigh upon our hearts and those who have asked for our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we ask that you fill the hearts of our brothers and sisters in America with the love that Jesus taught us, so peace and justice can replace this evil and hatred. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as you called your disciples to service, each with their own talents, bring before us this week opportunities to serve with compassion, love, and understanding. Hear now, Lord, the words which you taught the first disciples to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us then sing together our final hymn for this morning. We have a gospel to proclaim. You strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you and all whom you love, this day and forevermore. Amen.